بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all, and may every single one of us be blessed. My brothers and sisters, when something good happens to us, we feel that we are gifted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A true believer should realize that goodness comes to us by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who chooses that something good will happen to you. He is the one who chooses that something you want to happen to you will happen to you. And that would mean that automatically, if something we want for ourselves in terms of the good we think is for us does not come in our direction, that too is from the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ultimately, as much as we become happy when something good happens to us, we need to realize gratitude is owed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if there is a human being sometimes involved in the process, it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who involved that human being in the process. I give you an example. If I have a business and my business is struggling and I'm asking Allah to open the doors, and suddenly I have a huge amount of business that happens within a day, certain people come in and they purchase a large amount of items, what should I do? Should I go to the man and kiss his feet and say thank you? No, I thank Allah. Oh Allah, you sent someone to my place. And we need to realize sometimes that person can be a non-Muslim, it can be a Muslim, it can be anyone. So ultimately we treat our clientele very respectfully, understanding that it is Allah who sent them to us. Same applies. If a person is sick and ill, for example, they are making dua for cure. They have gone from pillar to post trying to get cure for their sickness, and they continue asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes you could meet a doctor who diagnoses exactly what is wrong. No one else said the same thing, and he is the first person who's actually correct. Do we go and kiss his feet? That's the question. The answer is no. We respect him, we thank him. But ultimately, the first thanks is owed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, the year has come to an end. We're talking of the Christian era, in the sense that we're living in a non-Muslim country whereby the year comes to a close and next year is going to be a better year. That's what we hear people say. Ultimately, let's understand, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single day, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who chooses what will happen to us. When something negative happens to me or to you, we need to look at it from a certain perspective. To start with, as believers, we need to ask ourselves, who is in charge? Is it me or is it Allah? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is happening to me, in whose hands is it? Well, there are two things involved. It is ultimately in the hands of Allah. That's the first thing. Then Allah gives the capacity to us to do certain things which would result in, for example, our own benefit, or sometimes if we don't utilize it properly, our own harm. So it's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but He gives us a capacity. Now, if we do not use that capacity, we are to blame. This is something that is clear cut in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he speaks of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we seek His help. He says, "Ista'in billah wa la ta'jaz." Seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but don't be lazy. Don't give up. Which means you have a capacity, you have energy. You want something good. Ask Allah's help and then ask yourself, what energy did Allah give me for me to achieve what I would like to achieve? Use that energy to its extent. For example, if you have a commodity for sale and no one knows about it because you did not advertise, and then you're blaming Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that no one is coming to buy your item. The reality is you're supposed to ask Allah, call out to Allah, make dua to Allah, and then tell yourself, Ya Allah, you've given me the idea, you've given me a capacity, I thank you for giving me the idea. Because that idea in your head is actually not your idea. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who put it in your head. And this is where Qarun went wrong. Let's listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Qarun. He was a very wealthy man from the nation of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah makes mention of him in the Quran. When he made a lot of money, or in whatever way he earned his wealth, that was a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his mistake was he related it to himself, not to Allah. So Allah says, we punished him as a result. قَالَ إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. He saw all that wealth of his and he says, definitely I have achieved this because of my own brain, my own education, my capacity, my knowledge. So Allah says, hey, hasn't he seen others before him who have been destroyed by Allah because of their disbelief in the power and ownership of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And this is why, take a look at our midst. Let's talk about our own society and community. And you know, with all due respect to everyone, if you take a careful look, you will come to one complete conclusion that nobody can deny. And that is, some of those who have a lot of wealth have barely any education. They have not crossed O level. Some of them have just about done O level, no PhD. And sometimes people who are struggling in life have a degree and they've got a postgraduate and they're struggling. This goes to show that ultimately your sustenance is with Allah. But when something happens against what you want, number one, thank Allah. That's not easy to do. Say for example, a person makes a little accident, they've bumped their car. A believer believes that we need to first say Alhamdulillah. That is the height of Iman. I thank Allah, I praise Allah upon all conditions. There's only one thing that I ask Allah to protect me from, and that is the condition of the people of hellfire, whether it is in the dunya or elsewhere. Meaning their condition while they are in the world, we should not want to at all be from amongst them, no matter how much of ease they might have in the world. And at the same time in the akhirah, in the life after death. So this is why you find the dua, Alhamdulillahi ala kulli hal. Do you know what that means? Praise be to Allah upon all conditions. All conditions, I praise Allah. You know, I got injured, Alhamdulillah, look, that was Allah. I thank Allah, I praise Him. The praise is due to Allah upon all conditions. But وَأَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ حَالِ أَهْلِ النَّارِ. I seek Allah's protection from the condition of those who will dwell in hellfire. We don't want that condition. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection. So a man, for example, has hurt himself. He suffered a loss in business. For example, he might have a little social problem in the extended family, so on. Point number one, we thank Allah. Or we praise, at least, praise Allah. Alhamdulillah. That is the height. It's not easy. You have to have solid iman to be able to do that, to say Alhamdulillah. Why? Because it could have been worse. Allahu Akbar. You lost one child. May Allah grant the child Jannah and make that child a means of your entry into Jannah as well. But you need to understand, even before you say Inna Lillahi wa Inna Ilayhi Raji'un, a true believer who has solid iman will say Alhamdulillah. I thank Allah. I praise Allah. Because I've got three children, one has been lost. Subhanallah. This is just an example I'm giving. The other two are alive. There are others who've lost all their kids and their entire families. What about them? We are far better if we've just lost one child. I'm not trying to minimize or trying to reduce the seriousness of the loss of life. No, not at all. But what we are trying to say is that, look at it from another perspective. A believer should always say, it could have been worse. So you had a little dent on your vehicle and you come out and you get excited like the world has come to an end. And you start swearing people, Wallahi my brother, you are failing the test of Allah. It could have been such big damage that your body would have been harmed. Allah saved your body, He saved your family, He saved everything. He took away from you a few hundred dollars that will be required for the panel beating. And guess what? In our country you can drive your car without it being panel beaten. Nobody will really pick on you because people know how it is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and may He make things easy for us. So let's look at it from the perspective of a believer, of a mu'min. And this is why I'm addressing this issue today, because currently in this country we are going through great turbulence and turmoil economically especially. And there is uncertainty in terms of the economics of the country, where a lot of people are finding things very expensive. The salaries perhaps do not tally with what is needed for a person's survival and so on. People have had to downgrade their lifestyle, and people across the globe are suffering in other ways. So Allah has tested you and I with some form of tests that are different perhaps from the tests of others. But sometimes if we were tested with their tests, and the little test that we have right now was actually eradicated, we might have suffered much more, and we might not appreciate that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to appreciate the fact that if He has chosen something for us to go through in terms of a test, He knows exactly why. He knows your capacity, He knows mine. And He knows it's very, very normal and natural to complain. But to complain to who? To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say, oh Allah, I'm struggling. You see, oh Allah, help me. That's part of ibadah. Imagine if everything was smooth and nobody suffered a cough, nobody had a flu, nobody actually went through economic hardship, nobody went through social difficulty in their homes or within their extended families. Who would then say, oh Allah, I'm struggling, help me, and I cry real tears, warm tears down my cheeks? It would not be happening so often, because we don't have an issue. But because Allah loves us, He creates an issue. That issue is actually a gift of Allah. So not all the days will be the same. Understand this. It's the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ. We will definitely test you. We will indeed test you in so many different ways. That means I need to sit and ask Allah, oh Allah, you said you are definitely going to test me. So please test me with tests that will be easy for me to go through, Ya Allah. And help me to go through those tests in a way that pleases you, O Allah. But nobody can actually think for a moment that I am not going to be tested by Allah. Because Allah promises in the Quran in more than one place, you're a believer. You said you're a believer. Well, we want to test that belief. Are you really a believer? This is what Allah says at the beginning of Surah Al-Ankabut. I'm sure we've heard these verses quite a few times. أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do the people think that it's enough for them to say we are believers, and then they expect Allah not to test them regarding the belief? In fact, when you're a believer, you will have more tests than those who don't believe, because they have not entered the school yet. When you go to school, you start getting examinations. You standing at the gate and outside, there are no tests for you, because even if a few people might ask you what's 1 plus 1 outside the gate, nobody's going to give you a certificate after that to say, wow, you passed. You are outside. The minute you come in, your examinations mean everything. And guess what? You will have systematic testing, one after the other. And the tests may become more and more difficult. Don't let that remove or reduce your iman. No. Don't think, why is Allah doing this to me? There's a simple answer. Because you're a believer. That's all. Because you're a mu'min, Allah wants to strengthen and polish up your iman. He will take away this from you. He will take away that from you. He will afflict you with this and with that. And your iman should become stronger as a result. Don't ever think, I want to take my life away because, you know, these problems are too much in my life. That is a sign of weakness of iman. Strengthen your iman and say, Ya Allah, I will live for as long as you keep me alive. And when you keep me alive, Ya Allah, help me through this life. And the day you take me away, grant me paradise. We are all human beings. We've been through difficulty and hardship of different levels. But at the same time, a winner is he or she who really can appreciate that Allah is in charge. Allah is in control. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةَ لَوِ اجْتَمَعَتْ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعُوكَ بِشَيْءٍ لَمْ يَنْفَعُوكَ إِلَّا بِمَا قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ لَكَ. You need to know, if the entire nation gets together to help you with something, they cannot help you unless Allah wants that help to reach you. وَاعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةَ لَوِ اجْتَمَعَتْ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ بِشَيْءٍ لَمْ يَضُرُّوكَ إِلَّا بِمَا قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ. If the entire ummah or the entire nation gets together to harm you, they will not be able to touch you except with that which Allah allowed to get to you. So if something got to you, people harmed you, they succeeded in that, it means it was a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah strengthen us. May Allah open our doors. So remember, when something evil happens to us, we perceive it as evil. Sometimes it's a blessing in disguise. For a mu'min, there is never something evil that can happen to them, because the hadith says, إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ. The affairs of a true believer are all amazing. They are amazing. You're a true believer? Anything that happens is amazing for you. It's something that is ajib. Why? Because the hadith says everything that happens to a believer can only be good. A believer is always in a win-win situation. In asabathu sarra'u shakara fakana khayran lah. Something good happens to you, you're happy, you're delighted. So it's better for you. Subhanallah. You thank Allah. Shakar. You know the shukr, the term shukr means to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You thank Allah. So it's better for you. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءُ صبر فكان خيرا له. And if something evil, something bad happens, something negative happens to a believer, he bears sabr, he is patient, and so that is better for a believer. This is why we always hear the scholars speaking of sabr and shukr. These two things, that Allah is with those who bear sabr. And definitely you want elevation in your status, thank Allah. لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you are grateful for what we've bestowed upon you, we will grant you increase. You will have increase. And my brothers and sisters, don't be mistaken. In the eyes of Allah, increase is not necessarily figures. It is more to do with barakah, blessing, contentment, and various other things. So sometimes, for example, my turnover in my business is $10,000 for a certain period. MashaAllah. And then I say, oh Allah, bless me, oh Allah, bless me. And in my heart, I just want $20,000. So for me, in my small mind, blessing is connected to another 10,000. But as a believer, we need to know that blessing is not connected to a figure. What's the point of having another 10,000? And then when you've got a lot of money, your attitude changes. Is that a believer? So Allah says, hang on, we know it's not good for you to have another 10,000 because your attitude will change. But because you're a good believer, we will keep it at 10 or perhaps reduce it to 5 so that you humble yourself down. Wasn't that better for us as believers? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. These are the different aspects and angles that we look at life from as believers. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors. Obviously, time is quite limited and we will be having a nikah. In a few moments, we'll be officiating a nikah. But what I'd like to say, my brothers and sisters, as a reminder for myself and yourselves, whenever we see others in hardship, never be happy at their hardship. Not at all. Because the hadith says, it will come round to hit you one day. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. It is possible that that thing will come round and hit you. لا تظهري الشماتة لأخيك فيرحمه الله ويبتليك. Don't ever become happy at the loss of your brothers and sisters when they've suffered in one way or another, no matter what. Because Allah is capable of having mercy on them and testing you and inflicting you with something even bigger or the same, some form of calamity and test. So this is one thing I need to learn. When something happens to them which is negative, no matter what your relation is with them in terms of good or bad, you must be able to feel in your heart, oh Allah, help the man, oh Allah, help the sister. Don't say, hey, good man, this person, double should have happened to them. That's the weakness of an iman. That's the weakness. That is not the sign of a mu'min. You become sad because, wallahi, it could have happened to me. It happened to them. It could have happened to me. And you make dua for them, Allah will protect you from the same. Secondly, when something good happens to someone else, don't become sad. Very important. Never become sad. You know, someone really wanted to marry a certain girl. And after some time, they found out, hey, another guy has proposed, and guess what? They're getting married. And you start gritting your teeth and you get angry and upset. Obviously, I've just thrown that example, seeing that there's a nikah today. It's not a real life example. But at the same time, why are you getting upset? Brother, that person's sustenance was written there. Why are you getting excited here? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Same applies with business. We get angry when another person who's running a similar business makes the money or strikes the deal. Why? Alhamdulillah for him. MashaAllah, be happy. Thank you. Oh Allah, bless him. And Ya Allah, bless me too. If you know that blessing lies in me not getting the deal, Alhamdulillah, I thank you because I know you're not going to keep me without food tonight. The problem is the second plate that we're not going to eat is what we're fighting about. Did you know that? The first plate we've all got by the will of Allah. The size of that plate differs. May Allah bless us with our food. Normally when we get angry and upset, it's all about extra and excess. It's not about basic minimums. Think about it. May Allah bless us all and grant us guidance and open our doors. Let our hearts become clean. That's one of the purposes why I spoke about this today, is in order to look at things and to be able to put them into perspective as a believer. And to have a good heart where we are happy for the happiness of others, we are never saddened because they are happy. And we are sad because of the sadness of others, we are never happy because of their sadness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all.